There's one card that for some reason is the basis for my decision to purchase High Frontier for All. There's just something about it that I found so captivating, and perhaps fans of the game will find it funny. But we're going to use this card and teach you a little bit more of this game here on Legendary Tactics. Now, this card struck me as being so unique and the mechanic for utilizing it to be so elegant that I just knew I had to give this game a try. But before I tell you what it is, let's take a look at this scenario. This time, we're going to do a quick scenario that will cover the rules concerning prospecting, flybys, glitches, heliocentric zones, and some other stuff. For my crew, I'm going to take the ESA again because I love their power sat ability. And because there's 6 patent decks, we will start with 6 aquas. The first card that I pick is the one that entranced me originally, the Photon Kite Sail. I love how the game handles the solar power and heliocentric zones. That will be another set of rules that we'll cover here. One of the people commenting on my last video pointed out that there's a special rule for solitaire games, which can be found in the appendix in the altruism scenario under rule V4C. This says that with the research auction operation, take the top card of a patent deck for the operation without bonus supports. This costs the number of aquas equal to 1 plus the number of seniority discs removed so far from the solar cycle. Since we are at the beginning of the game, it just costs 1 aqua. The Soul Sunspot cycle advances, triggering the event. I roll a 4, which is a pad explosion / space debris. Since I don't have any equipment in low Earth orbit, no problem there. My next move is to grab a Robonaut. On top is the phase-locked diode laser, which is nice, as it is light and it is a ray gun prospecting Robonaut, which I will get to a little bit later. It requires a generator, but is otherwise pretty good. This costs me another aqua. The sunspot cycle enters the yellow season. After that, I will take my generator for another aqua. The generator I get is the Photon Tether Rectenna, which is not very tough against radiation, but is light and self-sufficient, not requiring any other supports to function. That costs me an aqua. The sunspot cycle passes the first event in the yellow season, and I roll a 1. Inspiration. All the top cards go to the bottom of their respective decks. Whew! I grabbed what I needed just in time. For my next turn, I pay to boost my generator, my Robonaut, and my thruster into low Earth orbit to hang out with my crew. But not for long. We do a cargo transfer and create my rocket. And this is the kind of rocket that I find really captivating for some reason. The thruster is the sail. It has 0 mass. The Robonaut and the crew have a mass of 1 mass each, and the generator has a mass of 2. This gives us a total dry mass of 4, which puts us in the probe category. Because we are a probe, we get +1 to our net thrust. In addition to that, we have the ESA PowerSat bonus of +1 per turn, which we will be using every time. Basically, we're going to shoot a laser from Earth to help our little space sailboat along. The sail has 0 thrust on its own, but will be aided by both our low weight and our PowerSat to have a net thrust of 2. No fuel needed. We're on solar power. And the solar power is reflected in the heliocentric zones that you'll find on the map. I find it really neat and elegant. As the solar sail gets closer to the sun, it gets more thrust. Something in the Mercury zone will get +2. In the Venus zone, +1. And near Earth, +0. As you get further away from the sun, you begin to lose thrust. Mars is at -1. Ceres is at -2, Jupiter at -3, and so on. The sail just operates where it can get enough energy from the sun. So we're going to start flying and do our first burn at the cycler. Then we pass through the Van Allen radiation belt. This is going to be a bit of a risk. The photon kite sail is immune to the radiation, but the other items have to make a belt roll. I roll a 4. My net thrust is 2, which is subtracted from the die roll, so my net result is 2. The faster you're moving, the less exposure you have to the radiation, and that's reflected by that modifier. With some hazard checks, you can also pay the programmers 4 aquas to make sure that failure is not an option and avoid the hazard roll. However, belt checks are immune to that. If any of your equipment has a rad hard number that is lower than the net result, then that item is decommissioned. My crew and Robonaut survive easily, and my generator just scrapes by in this case. After that, our next burn is at the Earth-Luna Lagrange. And as I pass by the moon, I get a little boost from the gravity. If you look on certain planets and certain spaces, you can see that any spacecraft flying through that space gets an extra number of burns equal to the numbers in the black circle. This is known as a flyby. Venus, for example, is +2, although the flyby is only possible during season blue. Now, you do need to check for a glitch whenever you use the bonus thrust provided by a flyby. A glitch roll means you have to decommission any co-located cards with a matching rad hardness to the roll. I roll a 3, which means my Robonaut is decommissioned. I put a glitch token on the card. If this was an unmanned flight, that would be a big problem. But with some human beings on board, they were able to sort out the problem and make a repair with a repair glitch action. I like to think that it's given them something to do on the long ride out to outer space. The Luna flyby gives me 1 extra burn, and so I pick up steam, keep on rolling, pass the next burn, and make it to the Sol Mars Lagrange. I'm going to pivot here and go towards the green Aeneas route. Now normally, I would need to spend burns to pivot on this Homan point. But as you can see, on my thruster there's a picture of a little ballerina. That means that I can get a free pivot which doesn't use any burns. I will use that pivot to get into position to prospect the Taurid complex next turn. Not too bad. Using the moon's gravity and the power of the sun, I've made it pretty far in a year. But now that I'm in the Mars zone, my net thrust is decreased to 1. At this point, the power sat is all that I have keeping me maneuvering. Otherwise, I would just be coasting. The sunspot cycle advances. For my operation, I'm just going to take an aqua. I really need aqua to make sure that failure is not an option for that hazard space near my rocket, but that's going to take some time. I decide that time is of the essence, and I move into the crash hazard space, the debris field, and take the risk. I roll a 2. Whew, close. A roll of 1 would force me to involuntarily decommission every card in my rocket stack. Space travel is risky business. The Sol sunspot cycle moves past the event line, triggering the event. I roll a 1. Inspiration again. The cards reset. Now I will try to prospect. In order to prospect, you need a card with an ISRU rating, which stands for In Situ Resource Utilization. Cards have a rating from 0, which is the best, to 4, which is the worst. In order to prospect, as in refueling on a site, your card must have an ISRU number less than or equal to the hydration of the site. My Robonaut has an ISRU number of 3. Not great, but it is sufficient to prospect the Taurid complex. The great thing about my Robonaut is that it has a ray gun symbol, which means that I can prospect at a distance of up to one space. In fact, I can prospect any adjacent eligible space, even multiple sites, with a single operation. Each prospect operation is a glitch roll, so I roll the dice to see if anything malfunctions. I roll a 1. I check through my cards and there is no glitch, as there is no card matching the rad hardness of 1. There are no further modifications to my ISRU rating, and so I move on to the prospecting die roll. I need to roll a result equal to or less than the site size, in which case I will successfully prospect the site and place a claim disc on that site. The Taurid complex is pretty small though, only size 1, so I need to roll a 1 on my 6-sided die in order to get it. I roll the 1! Excellent! I place a claim disc on the site. If I had missed the roll, I would have placed a translucent red disc on the site, which means it is busted. A busted site means that there is nothing of interest and it cannot be prospected again by any player. You can still use the site for refueling though if you want to. So now, after prospecting a site successfully, it's time to head home. I move my rocket through the first burn space and take advantage of my free pivot. I can only get to the edge of the Earth heliocentric region because my thrust is so weak this far away from the sun. The sunspot cycle moves into the season red zone. For my operation, I will simply take another aqua. For the next move of my rocket, I pass through the burn space and I reach the Sol Venus Lagrange point. Now that I'm a lot closer to the sun, I have a lot more thrust to work with. The only downside is that there is a risk of a solar flare here because it's season red. It may have made some sense to stop the rocket a little bit further out at the Sol Earth Lagrange, for example, just in case. As the sunspot cycle advances, triggering the event, I hold my breath and roll. A 3. I add 1 to the roll because I am in the heliocentric zone near Venus. A 4 means pad explosion / space debris, where I would decommission a card with the highest math in low Earth orbit. Whew! Now that I am closer to the sun, and with my power sat ability and low weight, my net thrust is suddenly up to 3. I pass by Mercury to the Sol Mercury Lagrange point, turn a little bit to get to the Sol Earth Lagrange, and then pass through the Van Allen radiation belt. Perhaps I could have timed this better. Because we are in season red, there's a little more solar radiation out there, and I have to apply a +2 to my roll. I roll a 6. Uh-oh. I subtract my net thrust of 3, add +2 because of season red, and I end up with a result of 5. Everything on board is decommissioned, a euphemism that unfortunately includes the crew. Almost everything would have survived if it wasn't season red. Bad timing and planning on my part. Heads will probably roll over this. It is a sad, tragic day for the ESA. The thruster, the photon kite sail, is immune to flare and belt rolls. And so it continues its lonely way home to low Earth orbit. Space is a deadly place, as we learned today. There's lots that can go wrong, and that often happens. So while I apologize for the sad ending to our video, I hope it gave you some more insight into how to play High Frontier. As this is a learning game for me as well as for most of the viewers, I hope more advanced players will take a moment to comment on any rules mistakes I may have made through the course of this mission, despite my best efforts to catch everything. As much as it is motivation for me to learn this great game, I am hoping that a video like this and others to follow will ease new players into it as well. Thank you for watching. If you enjoyed this, please let me know with a like and subscribe down below. This is NATO with Legendary Tactics.